Hey, I'm Doug. Welcome to Backcountry Pilgrim, a channel that is all about hiking, camping, and backpacking, and the gear that goes with it. This is the fourth in my Getting Started Backpacking series. In the first one, we talked about backpacking in general, and then we started looking at the big three pieces of gear. So in the second video, we talked about choosing your first backpack. In the third video, we looked at tents and hammocks. And now in the fourth video, we're going to talk about our sleep system. Now, basically, your sleep system has two main functions: to keep you warm and to keep you comfortable, usually in that order. And in order to do that, you're going to need something under you and something over you. If you think about your sleep system at home, you basically have a bed with blankets on top of it. And that is sort of the same thing that happens with a sleep system when you're backpacking. You've got some kind of mattress, something that goes under you for comfort, and something that goes over you for warmth. However, in backpacking, it is important to note that the mattress, the thing that goes under you, the sleep pad, is actually a key component to warmth as well as to comfort. So we don't want to discount that section at all. Beginning backpackers especially typically don't realize the importance of having a really good sleep pad as part of your sleep system. To understand how these two pieces function, consider the difference between convection and conduction. Convection is basically heat loss that goes out into the air. Conduction is heat loss into an object, such as the planet. If it is cold outside and you are laying on the bare ground, you're going to lose a lot of heat as your body tries to make the planet the same temperature as you. In most cases, the planet wins. Consider this. What would feel colder? Walking out into a 32-degree day with your arms exposed, or taking a 32-degree ice cube and putting it right on your skin. So it's very important that what goes under you, your sleep pad, be a good one and fit the conditions you're going to be sleeping in. So we're going to start off by talking about the sleep pad, and we'll get to sleeping bags and quilts in the second half of the video. Before we get into the different materials and weights and all that kind of stuff, it is very important to understand how sleeping pads are rated as far as their warmth, and this is known as their R value. R stands for resistance, and it's a standard measure for insulation of all kinds, but as of 2020, the standard has been developed for sleeping pads. Now, if you're just getting started shopping for sleeping pads, this should not be an issue. You're going to see the ASTM certification rating on practically anything you shop for. But if you're looking at something a little older, you might want to do a little bit of research and make sure that you are comparing apples to apples, because it really was only in 2020 that this standard was developed and started to become ubiquitous across manufacturers. The R value tells you how resistant your sleeping pad is to transferring heat. So a higher number is going to keep you warmer, but it is not necessarily going to make you hot. Some people worry that if they get one with too high of an R value and they go out to sleep in the summer, it's going to be too warm. In most cases, that is not really what happens, but it is a consideration if you are a very warm sleeper. You'll typically see R values from about 1 to 6. Anything higher than 6 is going to be for pretty extreme conditions that a beginning backpacker is probably not going to find themselves in. Now, it's important to note that R values do not index to temperature ratings. All you're finding out is how much resistance to heat loss you're going to have, and how warm you actually are is dependent on a number of other factors. However, in general, an R value of, say, 1 to 2 is probably only going to be good for summer warm sleeping on the ground. When you get up into the 3s and 4s, you're starting to move into the 3 season, adding fall and spring. You get into 5 and 6, now you've got a 4 season pad. Another thing that's important to note about sleep pad R values is that they stack. And what that means is, if you have, say, a sleep pad with an R value of 2, if you put it on top of another sleep pad with an R value of, say, 1, you now have a total R value of 3. Now, in many situations, that's not terribly handy, because you don't really want to carry a whole bunch of gear with you just to stack it all up. But what it does do is give you a little bit of leeway for buying your first sleep pad. If you're not entirely sure what to get, just get the warmest one you think you will probably need. You can always add another one or two R-value pad into it if you find that it is not warm enough. Okay, so let's get into the different kinds of sleep pads. They come in two basic kinds of material. One of them is foam, and one of them is air. Here is kind of your old school bedroll type foam pad. This is known as a closed cell, and that is because the cells of the foam are closed off. They're not open, so this is smooth. It's not like a sponge. If you get it wet, the water's gonna run right off of it. Something like this is nice because it is very lightweight. It is also very inexpensive. It's also very reliable because you can't poke holes in it and have it leak air. However, as you can see, it's quite bulky. This is not going to collapse down and fit inside most backpacks like something like this would. Further, something like this is not the most comfortable of sleep pads. It's not going to give you a whole lot of protection against the ground, but it will be a lot more comfortable than simply lying on the ground. A step up from the classic bedroll would be something like a Z-pad. These are kind of fun because they open up very quick and you can just fold them back up together, put them away. You'll see a lot of these out on the trail. They often have a reflective surface which reflects heat, and they fold up very easily and quickly, and they are fairly comfortable. Now, pads like these are gonna have an R value of about 2. So these are not gonna do a whole lot of good as far as warmth retention by themselves, so they're not really sufficient for 4 or maybe even 3 season sleep pads. However, remember that they can stack. Putting 2 of these on top of each other or adding one of these to another sleep pad system is going to increase your warmth and comfort. Another nice thing about these is that they can be used like in the snow or something as an extended sit pad. So if you're kicking back in the snow and you want to sit down and you don't really want to get up and be soaking wet, you can just throw the pad down and use it as a chair. Still in the foam sleep pad category is something like this right here, which is a so-called self-inflating sleep pad. What makes these self-inflating is that although they do rely on air, they're kind of a hybrid. Inside the pad is a spongy material. The pad will actually inflate, I don't hear that, all by itself. But in the end, you have a nice open cell foam sleep pad that also has the benefit of being an air mattress. Let's see, I don't even see R value listed on this. This is just a cheapo. I'll look it up and put it over here somewhere if I find it. Now the benefit to a pad like this is that you are kind of getting the benefits of an air mattress as well as a foam pad. You don't need to worry as much about punctures or leaks because it's gonna function at least minimally, even if it has no air in it. It does collapse down decently, although not as good as a full air pad. And it is by far the heaviest of all the options. So you're kind of getting the best of both worlds, but you're also kind of getting the worst of both worlds. What you're typically going to see in backpacking is some kind of small, ultralight, inflatable air pad, like this Nemo Tensor. So inside this little package is a full 20-inch by 6-foot long air pad that I can use to keep me warm and also to keep me off the ground. So these are extremely comfortable and they have a higher R value. This is where you're going to start seeing the 3s, 4s, 5s, even 6s, depending on how much insulation is inside them. Now, some of these are non-insulated, and what that means is that they are literally just the air pad. Those are going to have an R value back down around 2. However, different companies use different means to insulate these. Some of them are actually filled with typical insulation like down. Others use space blanket kind of technology to reflect heat. And however they do it, what they are doing is increasing the R value of the pad so that it is going to be warmer. Now, of course, that also means that there's going to be more material, which means it's going to be heavier and less compressible. So this is where stacking your sleep pads can come in handy. Let's say you get a really good deal on a non-insulated pad. You can pair this with something else that maybe has another additional function that this doesn't, and between the two, you will have a sleep system that will keep you warm in 3 or maybe even 4 seasons. However, just keep in mind that the stacking strategy dramatically increases the bulk and the weight of your kit. So following my recommendations for your other gear, I would look at something that's going to work in a typical three season in your area. Now, your area is important. Just because something says three season doesn't mean it's going to be three season everywhere. The coldest night I ever spent in the backcountry was in July in California. So definitely keep in mind what you think you're going to be facing where you are backpacking. However, if I had to make a general recommendation for beginning backpackers, I would definitely recommend an air pad and one that is insulated with an R value of about 4. Two other considerations on a sleep pad that you might want to look into. Number one, the standard width on a sleep pad is 20 inches. Now, if you are a tosser and turner, or you like to sleep all splayed out, or you flip around a lot, you're a side sleeper, whatever, you might want to look at a wider sleep pad. Now, of course, that's going to mean more weight and more bulk, but it is worth it at night to not be falling off your pad onto the cold tent floor. Also, keep in mind that some air mattresses come with an inflatable bag, like a bellows almost, that helps you inflate the pad quickly and also keep your breath from entering the pad and the moisture from it getting inside your insulation and messing it up. If you do no other research, that should at least get you started. All right, now that we have discussed what is under you and talked about the sleep pad, let's talk about what is over you. And this is where you're probably going to be in a bit more familiar territory, even if you're a beginner, because now we're going to talk about sleeping bags, but we're also going to be talking about something called a sleeping quilt, which you may not have heard of, but which I would definitely consider getting. Now, you are probably already familiar with the standard sleeping bag. This is a quasi-mummy bag, and what that means is that it is tapered to fit the body so that you don't have as much air inside the sleeping bag to fill with your warmth, and that makes it warmer, it also makes it lighter, and it also makes it more compressible. If you had one of those big rectangular sleeping bags as a kid, those are great for car camping, but you're not typically going to want one of those when you're backpacking. The mummy system is usually going to have a hood that covers your head. You can usually cinch this down so that it just comes right around your face. You're going to have side zippers to get in and out. It'll often have a collar and maybe a baffle along the zipper to keep air from leaking out from anywhere. And something like this has kind of been the standard sleep system for backpackers for years. A quilt, on the other hand, is actually an open blanket that usually joins down toward the bottom, more like a sleeping bag. So it's like a sleeping bag on the bottom and a blanket up on top. Now, why would you want something like a quilt instead of a full sleeping bag? The basic reason has to do with how sleeping bags and quilts insulate. Sleeping bags and quilts insulate by keeping a layer of warm air close to your body. Now, they do this by filling the layers of the material with some kind of insulation. Typically, you're going to see one of two kinds, either down feathers or some kind of synthetic. Now, neither down nor synthetic insulation actually keep you warm. What they do is they keep the layers separated and trap air between those layers that get heated by your body. So once the bag lofts up, there's a whole bunch of air in here that isn't going anywhere, and as you sleep in the bag, your body warms that air, and as long as it isn't escaping too fast, you are going to become warm. The benefit of down is that it is very light and very compressible. So for example, my quilt is a down fill, and I can get this entire quilt into a stuff sack this small. This sleeping bag is a synthetic fill, and it is not going to get very small. The downside of down is that it is fairly expensive, and it also does not perform well if it gets wet. So you do have to be extremely careful to keep down jackets, down quilts, down sleeping bags dry, because once they get wet, your trip is basically over. Now, that's not to say that a synthetic bag is going to be comfortable when it's wet, but it can retain its heat properties because of what synthetic is made of. Water doesn't make it collapse, and so the loft can remain. So now that we understand how sleeping bags or quilts keep you warm, consider what happens when you get inside a typical sleeping bag. So you get inside a sleeping bag and lie down, and your body compresses that fill material down to where it is no longer providing any real insulation. Because remember, it's not the insulation that keeps you warm, it's the air. And if you lie down on something like this, you squeeze all the air out. And what that means is that you now have all this material that you paid for and that you carried in and that took up weight in your backpack, and it is now doing you almost no good. The idea with a quilt is that they are basically removing the material that you wouldn't be using anyway. And what that does is it makes for a much lighter, a much more compressible, and even a less expensive sleep system. Part of the issue is that because the sleeping bag is meant to be a cocoon, so to speak, it's got the hood, it's got the draft collar, it's got a zipper, it's got baffles on the zipper, and it has all of that material that's going to get crushed when you lie down in it. And all of that is extra weight and bulk that you may not need and which may not even do you any good. A comparable sleeping bag and quilt are going to differ in weight by about 30%. So this is a huge difference in weight savings. Now, the good news with a sleeping bag is that it is very simple. You lay it out, you get in, you zip it up, and you're basically done. Other than minor adjustments, there's just not a whole lot you need to do to make a sleeping bag work. However, that also makes it more limited. It is more difficult to get temperature control in a sleeping bag because about the only way to change the temperature is to simply unzip the bag. The good news with a quilt is that because of the way it's made, you don't have the hood, the collar, the baffle, the zippers. You're not having any weight penalty for those features. It is much more modular, meaning if you need something on your head, instead of relying on your sleep system, you put a hat on. If you need something higher up, maybe enveloping your shoulders, you put a puffy jacket on. You're probably going to be sleeping in layers of clothing anyway, and so you don't need anything on the bottom of you, because that's where your sleeping pad goes. Further, quilts have a lot better temperature variance. It is much easier to regulate your temperature when you're using a quilt than it is with a sleeping bag because you're not encased in it. Some of them, like mine, come with an open foot box. And what that means is that I can actually open this up and let a draft in through the bottom. Now, some of the warmer quilts don't have this feature. That is one of the nice things about quilts is that many of these are being made by cottage manufacturers that will make them to your exact specifications. In fact, there's whole videos just on how to pick out what quilt features you want. If you get the right one, it can do a lot more than a sleeping bag can. Now, the downside to a quilt is that it does take a bit more practice and a bit more work to get it to work right. When this is laid out on a sleeping pad, it's very easy, as you can imagine, to get drafts. And so there are straps that come with these that attach them to the pad. And again, you're going to have to do a little bit of work to get it dialed in. However, if temperature regulation is important to you, you're going to be doing those kinds of things in order to make yourself more comfortable. And the fact that you can do it at all with a quilt can be a huge bonus. That temperature regulation also means that you're not necessarily going to have several pieces to your sleep system. So for example, if you're trying to do 3-season backpacking, and there's a big temperature variance in your area between, say, summer and fall, you might end up needing 2 sleeping bags, because the one that's going to take care of you when it's colder is going to be way too hot when it's warm, and vice versa. However, if you have a quilt that can take care of you in pretty cold circumstances, it is very easy to modify your setup when it's warmer. You can stick a foot out the bottom, you can get your arms out easily, you can lift up part of it for airflow, you can even open the whole thing if it isn't a closed foot box, and just use it as a blanket. Now, some people will say, yeah, but you know, quilts are a lot more expensive. That is not necessarily true. In fact, the opposite is often the case. At the low end, yes, you can get sleeping bags for cheaper than quilts. There aren't really a lot of low-end quilts. However, once you get up to a legitimate backpacking sleeping bag, one that isn't overly heavy or overly bulky, you're going to start paying for that. And really, that's where the quilt starts to overtake the sleeping bag, because you're not paying for a whole bunch of fill that you're not going to use. You're not paying for zippers. You're not paying for collars. You're not paying for baffles. There's actually a number of things that you don't have to pay for when you get a quilt that you do have to pay for with a sleeping bag. Now, when you're looking at warmth ratings for sleeping bags or quilts, they do typically come in degrees of temperature. There's no R value or anything like that. There is a standard for measurement called the EN or the ISO standard. And if you can find that, that would be very helpful when comparing across brands. However, those standards are a little murky. In fact, often you will see multiple temperature ranges on a single piece of gear. And here is why. How warm you are in a sleeping bag has a lot to do with many factors that the sleeping bag has nothing to do with. The R value of your sleeping pad, the warmth of the base layers that you're wearing, your own typical body temperature. There are a number of factors that change how warm a sleeping bag is going to keep you because, again, the warmth is coming from you, not from it. So if you see a sleeping bag or quilt that it follows these standards, instead of just saying, this is a 20-degree bag or this is a 30-degree bag, you'll often see multiple numbers. I usually see three, but sometimes there are four different temperature ranges. And I've also seen different descriptions of what each of these mean. First, you might see an upper limit. This is the warmest temperature that you would probably want to use the sleeping bag in. One description says that this is the temperature at which a standard male can sleep without excessive perspiration, with the hood and zippers open and arms outside the bag. That's actually a somewhat unusual rating. Typically, people are more concerned about cold than warmth, and so that brings us to the comfort rating. The comfort rating is the temperature at which a standard female can expect to sleep comfortably in a relaxed position. Now, unfortunately, the comfort rating is the one that is often confused with the temperature rating of the bag if it is just a single rating. So, for example, if you walk into a store and they say, oh, this here is a 20-degree sleeping bag, they are probably not talking about the comfort rating. When you just see a single temperature rating on a bag, that is usually referring to what is known as the survival or transition or lower limit. This is the temperature at which a standard male can sleep for 8 hours in a curled position without waking. Now, it's important to keep in mind that these standards are assuming a warm sleep pad. I've read that it has to be an R value of 4.8. I'm not sure about that. It is also assuming that this person is wearing base layers. It is also assuming this person is a male. Males typically sleep warmer than females. It also assumes that this person is in a sleep system inside a tent. So when you combine all of that together, the lower limit or the transition rating isn't necessarily telling you that you're going to be comfortable. What it means is that if you are a typical male with a fairly heavily resistant sleep pad, wearing base layers, in a tent, you will probably make it through the night. When I see a bag with a standard single temperature rating, I automatically add 10 or 15 degrees. And that brings us to the survival or the extreme rating. This is the minimum temperature at which a standard female can remain for 6 hours without risk of death from hypothermia. Okay, so it is very important to note that the extreme rating on a bag is not telling you how far to push the bag. What it's saying is it is possible to not die in this temperature. However, in the end, again, remember how insulation works. It is your body and the air that is trapped by the bag that is going to keep you warm. It is not the insulation itself. And so the performance of the sleeping bag or sleeping quilt is going to be massively dependent on a number of factors that have nothing to do with the bags. It's a sleep system, and the whole system has to work together, and you are a part of that system. You are actually the most important part of the sleep system because you are the one providing the heat. Although I can give recommendations, you're going to have to try out a couple different things and see what works for you. So what would I recommend for the beginning backpacker? To be honest, this is kind of a tough call. There's a part of me that wants to say, just go out and get a good sleeping bag. Sleeping bags are pretty simple, they're pretty difficult to mess up, and you're probably already used to how they work. Quilts, on the other hand, require a bit of practice. You've really got to kind of figure out the system and dial it in to get it to work well. However, quilts are so much better than sleeping bags in so many situations. It's difficult for me to just give the nod to the sleeping bag. Scores of people have switched from a sleeping bag to a quilt after trying them out. As far as I know, I have never seen a video where someone who uses a quilt switches back to a sleeping bag. Now, the caveat to this is that if you are going to be in extreme temperatures, eventually the sleeping bag system overtakes the quilt system as far as working in extreme cold situations. But when I say extreme cold, I mean extreme cold, like Antarctica, North Pole. And when you get to that level, everything changes. You've got to have a new tent. You've got to have a new sleeping pad. But for the typical three-season backpacker, a good, say, 20-degree quilt is probably going to be sufficient. So what I would say is this. If you're kind of hesitant about this whole backpacking thing and you're a little freaked out about trying out the new gear, get a good sleeping bag. You're never going to not want to have a good sleeping bag. They're handy for so many situations, even just as a loner. However, if you think you've got a little bit of time to experiment and you have time to do some good research, I would strongly recommend looking into a quilt. The cost savings, the weight savings, the space savings, the modularity, there is just so much to recommend a quilt that even though it does have a higher learning curve than a sleeping bag, that learning curve has huge payoffs. Now, because of the importance of your sleep system as well as its cost, you definitely want to do some more research. So I'm just going to leave it here and say that if the quilt interests you at all, definitely do a deeper dive into this kind of product and see what you think. Okay, last but not least, we need to talk about pillows. Pillows in backpacking are anything from just a stuff sack full of dirty clothes all the way up to an ultralight inflatable. Some of these pillows are insulated, just like sleep pads. Some of them even have straps to keep them from falling off your sleep pad. I'm not going to go into a whole big thing on pillows. I'll put some links in the description below, as well as to all the other gear that I have talked about. But basically, keep in mind two things. Number one, all of the same factors that go into the rest of your backpacking gear have to be considered when you're looking at a pillow. How much does it weigh? How small does it get? The biggest difference with the pillow and the other parts of the sleep system is that this is the piece that's going to be in direct contact with your body. You're going to be putting your face and your head on this pillow, and so the comfort of the outer layer is going to be very important. Look for something that actually feels good the way you sleep. The good thing about backpacking pillows is that they are relatively inexpensive, and you're not really going to kill yourself trying a couple different kinds until you find the one that you like. All right, we have gone over a lot, but your sleep system is so important. If you mess up on your backpack, you're probably just going to be uncomfortable. If you mess up on your tent, if you mess up on your tent, you may not be in the most comfortable position when you wake up the next day. But if you mess up your sleep system, it's going to be expensive to fix, and it is probably going to ruin your trip more than a mistake in any other area. All right, I hope this video has helped you out, informed you, entertained you. If it has, would you mind giving it a like? And if you're not a subscriber to Backcountry Pilgrim, why don't you hit that red button down there and also click on that bell so that you get all of the notifications when my new videos come out. Until next time, I'm Doug. This is Backcountry Pilgrim. Thanks for watching. Mm-hmm.